Hello everyone, this is a short question and answer session on gate preparation strategies. I welcome you all. I'll begin now. If you have any questions, please interrupt me and just ask me questions. So a little bit about myself. I am Manoj. I am a current second semester student in IISc Bangalore. I graduated in 2017 in chemical engineering from NIT Durgapur. I was working in a consulting firm for 1 year, and then I quit my job to write GATE 2019. And I hope the certain things that are followed in my GATE preparation will be hopefully helpful to you. I'll prefer this to be in a question and answer format. So for the first few minutes, I'll speak about generic approaches and then I'll take your questions. Hi. So the thing to know is before everything started, I wanted to I asked myself a few questions. What I really wanted to do with my career, so it gave me certain answers, and as per those answers, I basically took my action plan. So I really wanted to work in flight vehicles, flight dynamics, and those sort of stuff, which were completely alien to me. And for that reason, GATE seemed like a very seemed like a first step towards realizing my goal, and that's where I started putting my efforts towards realizing it. So okay, that's all background. Coming to GATE, which is coming to GATE. So basically, the GATE's philosophy is you understand all the concepts, and then you try to solve the problems to crack the problem. So even your teachers might be telling you that first you have to understand a concept properly before you attempt a problem. If you just directly go into a problem, you will not be able to solve it. So that's the ideal way you prepare. First you focus on the concepts, the problems will be automatically solvable. So as sir mentioned to you before, that most subjects were new to me except fluid dynamics. So there is only one source that I could trust properly, and that is a classroom. So in whatever sequence that the teachers were teaching me, I had to trust them. And in fact, it's a huge syllabus, right? So you need to follow a certain sequence before you can move on to the next stage. So for example, if you want to study thin wall structures, you have to give your solid mechanics basics, right? Your bars, shafts, beams, etc., before you move on to something like unsymmetrical bending. So you have to follow the classroom sequence, and our teachers have already done the management for us, just follow the sequence. No need to think more about what's going to happen or what's not going to happen. Just follow, dedicate enough time to each topic. So basically that's it. And so I was working for 1 year in a startup that was rapidly growing, and we were two people handling a big project. So it was a very stressful experience, but I was learning at a rapid pace. So this is something that took into my brought into my GATE preparation. You cannot work under stress. If you're stressed, you cannot understand what you're reading. So you need to have an ample amount of time for your GATE preparation. The syllabus is so huge that you cannot think of say starting in the late August or September and hope to finish everything. That's not possible. That might be possible for some, I do not know, but for me it's not possible because I cannot study under stress. So I gave myself ample amount of time. I started on May 5th, 2018. So from May 5th till November end, it was entirely on the concept building phase, covering the entire syllabus. So it's a lot of time I gave myself, and because I had a lot of time to prepare, did not reduce stressful at all. And moreover, when you were stuck.
Hi, Manoj.
Yeah, hello.
Yeah, hi, I'm Palak. So I have this question. When you were preparing for this thing, for GATE, were you still working?
No, I had quit my job by then. I had completed my notice on April 28th, and then on May 5th, I started my preparation.
So after quitting your job, you started preparing for GATE?
Yeah. So the job, me doing the job was a two-fold process. First, understand how real world jobs work, because up till then I did not have any experience. So a job, it gave me a lot of experience on how to handle projects. And number two, I had to build some financial backing, some financial resources So because staying when I was working, I was in Kolkata, and Kolkata you don't find any good coaching, and I was trying to switch my field, so I would definitely need coaching. So I would have needed to move somewhere else, and then I don't think that I since I am switching my field, we having a job and then preparing would not have worked at all. So it had to be a full time preparation, plus I had to have enough financial resources to survive for 1 year. So it was a bit planned. I had planned it from my final year itself. How long to work and how to survive in a new city without a job, because, and of course, Bangalore is expensive. It was not expensive in the area I was staying. I was pretty frugal, but you still need some money to for 1 year.
Yeah.
So does it help you?
No, actually, because I'm working.
Okay, so I might not be the best person to ask about how to manage your work and your preparation, because I was doing it full time, of course. So I do not know how the dynamics work. But a few of
sorry, Manoj. Yes, Palak. So we will have one session with Mr. Sasi Pawar. So he was one of very good ranker in EC while working. So definitely he may answer you in better way in the coming days. Okay. Yeah, sure.
One of my friend was working, and his statement was after he came back from office, he took a 1 hour nap and then just to fresh up his mind and then start preparing. But
so to be very like just a general question, how many hours did you use to study a day?
I actually did not count, because it was a stop and go. It's a start and stop procedure. So I'd wake up. So I weekdays I'd be free, right? And because I was already in the startup work mode, it was very stressful. So every day, every morning I'll wake up, I'll just think like I'm going to office. But instead, it's an office, it's a preparation. So I'd wake up in around 9 a.m., have my breakfast, and if it's not a Monday, then directly jump into the preparation, covering some certain topic and whatever work we have to do. And then after 1 hour, take a break. And it might be a total of, say, 8-9 hours per day.
So when you joined this institution, you were not working at the time?
No, I was not working. It was not going to work out for me, because I was new to this field. And which branch are you from?
I'm from instrumentation.
Okay, so you do have some background in instrumentation, so sensors or control theory or dynamics or simulation. If you have the background from college, you have some lead. So
Branch were you from?
I was from chemical engineering. If you do a master's in chemical engineering, you don't get to work for flight dynamics. I wanted to do flight dynamics. I wanted to do GNC. GNC is guidance navigation control.
I'm Raj.
Hi, yeah.
Then why do you choose chemical engineering for BTech if you are interested in UAV?
So these career decisions were actually, I took these career decisions after I graduated. So a lot of people take a lot of time to make a good career decision. So till after 12, I was completely clueless. Even during BTech, I was not having any clue at all. I did not study properly. In fact, because of the very reason that I did not know what to do. So these career decisions actually came to me when I graduated. After I was free from the chain of, college and school, and then, I was free to think. So then I thought, okay, this is not what I want to do. I don't want to work in consulting. I don't want to, say, be in a board meeting with a bunch of high profile people and delivering presentations and making PPTs and just sweating it. I did not like it. Although I learned a lot from it, the experience, I did not like it. So I just asked myself what I wanted to do. So that led to this situation. A lot of people actually go for MBA after their BTech.
Yeah.
Because that's if you don't have any particular choice and if you want to have a fulfilling career, MBA is like the general purpose. In fact, the work I was doing was related to MBA rather than engineering. But again, these are all personal questions that you need to ask. And in fact, this is the motivation that will keep you throughout. Because I knew that, my work has to be this. My work has to be, trajectory optimization in a UAV company. And I need this role. I was, looking up people who work in GNC. And GNC is, people from electronics engineering, control engineering, instrumentation, all come and do GLC. So it's a pretty exciting field. So I wanted to get there. So this was the main motivation that kept me stuck to my, you know, GATE preparation, because GATE is just one step, right? You have to work for 2 years in masters, and even if you don't understand, you have to work a lot. So yeah, that will, if you can answer the difficult questions, that will keep you stuck in the preparation. Don't just, you know, throw darts in the blind, because that's not focused enough.
So was it this kind of thing, like in the class you were always able to solve all the questions?
No, absolutely not. In fact, I remember a lot of times I could not solve anything in class. Most of the problems, you see, it's all topics are new to me.
One thing I will add, many times people were laughing on him. So I used to say, those who laugh now on him, he will laugh on them further. Because he used to ask many questions. It's not about always solving. He was more curious than anybody else.
So since you are from a different background, I can't give you an aerospace example, but abstractly when you see a difficult problem, naturally nobody can solve it in first attempt. They have to like pry it open. So
Manoj, actually what happens with me, like for example, when I see some GATE questions, there are like literally like these kind of questions which I think like I won't be able to solve at that time. So how does it work?
Okay, so my question to you is, which company are you working and how do you handle your project? Who are you reporting to? Who's your reporting manager? How do you work out with the manager if you have some task in the company?
So like I do not directly report to my manager. I report to my TN.
Okay.
So whatever is given to me, I try to complete it as soon as possible and not to tell them that I've completed it, so that I get ample amount of time to study.
Okay, no, I'm talking about you do get some problems assigned to you and you have to solve them and then submit as a deliverable.
No, not as daily variable, but it happens like for example, nowadays we are assigned a project.
Okay.
So so daily 7 to 8 hours go, like I have to spend in like working for office and all.
Yeah, you have to present some work, right? You have to solve some problem and present the work to your
hire. Yes.
Yeah, so this is the same thing. When you see a problem here, don't expect it to solve in first attempt or even second attempt. You have to... I was repeatedly, you know, hammering on the problem until I solved it. So that would happen if I see a difficult problem, or if you see a new problem, or if you, like you said, you have a GATE problem, right? Some of them are very tricky. You can't...
Yeah.
When you're starting out, you can't solve it at one go. So yes. So if once you see, say you see a problem from electromagnetic theory, don't have a good background or you have not finished your topics. So first thing to do is, okay, I need to cover this amount of topics to be actually able to understand what the problem is speaking. So you have to cover the topics first. So that is of course a long journey. Okay. You have to finish.
And one more thing has happened, like there is a 2 years gap. Like after 2 years, I've started preparing for GATE. So it's been like I was graduated 2 years back. So like, I think there is some discontinuity.
That's not a problem. That's not a problem, because I also started from afresh. That's actually a bigger advantage. If you put enough effort, you can learn it properly now. Earlier, you might not have learned your subjects properly, but now you get another chance to just go through that again. Just have to put the effort. And if you know, cover the concepts and then you read the problem, you will see that, okay, first time I was not able to understand it, but now after covering this many concepts, these concepts that are required for this, okay, now I can crack the problem, maybe have a go at it. Then again, if you're not able to solve it, again, discuss. As I always say, discuss with your friends. Don't try to, you know, seek help, because alone you cannot do anything. I was spamming the group, WhatsApp groups with questions. I would write, I purchased notebook, and then write, work out till what point I will not be able to solve. And then I'll post in the group and then ask people. And people would chime in with their opinion that how, okay, this is not the way you do. You go this way, try that approach. And after a lot of iterations, the solution came out.
Yeah.
So this is the practice part. So once you do this enough time, you will realize, okay, GATE actually follows a very set syllabus. And once you have conquered the syllabus, then next time, by the end of November, you will be able to solve most of the problems. And you will even congratulate. Yeah.
So by November, all the subjects were completed for you. Like, as per your, you were very confident that you will be able to solve every problem. Was it something like that, or you were still unconfident?
No, that it's the confidence will build. I cannot say that on in July.
Palak, it is like this. We have sets of assignments, so yeah. It's not necessary. Like he was able to solve each problem which we were solving in classes, but he was solving all the assignments. He was attending all topic-wise exams. Some exams might he couldn't attend, but he has attended each and every exam.
Yeah, and I failed a lot of mock tests also. I scored some difficult mock tests. I scored 10, 15% out of 100. I flunked a lot of mock tests. But after attempting a mock test, I'll go back and again solve it like an assignment. Okay, let's see what I could not solve, and let's try to solve it using what I've learned. And what was the loop for figuring out the loopholes.
And one more good thing here, Palak or anyone, whatever promise we do, almost we complete syllabus in that time period, and we go. We have given equal importance to every subject. Okay, not like one subject is stressed for many months, and some other subject were taken only for a few days. So that way he has built good expertise.
There's the classroom emphasis. Even you need to parallel or mirror the same emphasis on your own preparation back home. Because as I was saying, on every 5-day week, on a 5-day week, you divide it two days, 1 half-day, 1 half-day for 3 subjects. So every week I would aim to cover material from each subject. So 3 subjects per week.
And and one more thing, it's not about over the period we progress, we will be completing many subjects. Okay, like now we have completed few subjects, so that also you have to keep revising, and that's where he was always putting efforts to keep revise the backtrack and whatever coming new subjects also. And of course he was fully preparing, so he had ample amount of time to do more.
Yeah, so this is I think the question about we have another question. I'll take it after I've answered the confidence part. Actually, initially when you don't have confidence, you have to have trust on the classroom sequence. The way your teachers are teaching right now, you don't have confidence in I'll be able to solve this problem after say tomorrow or day after tomorrow. So you have to just trust the teachers, what topics they're covering. Read the book, class notes, and then make your own notes. That is very crucial. So after you do this, you have covered a lot, some part of the material, you start slowly getting confidence that this is how, if I do it, I'll be able to solve this problem. And that's how you build the confidence over time. We have another question. Sir, after the class is over, you stick to only that or study further more about the topic? Okay, so in classroom, it is not possible for any person to be teaching any topic in extremely detailed way. It's fairly or 100, more or less 100% complete. But the classroom itself will not enrich, give you the extra information that you want. So you have to read a book. If you are, from your electrical background, your circuit theory is a subject that you require for. I do not know. You might need circuit theory for your gate. And if your teacher has taught Norton's theorem and Thevenin's theorem in class, he has done lots of problems. He has explained how this works. It's fairly sufficient. But you need to go back and learn, read a book on circuit theorem. How does this actually work? Okay, the book will also have lots of examples on this Thevenin's reduction, voltage equivalent voltage source, and all those things. So yes, you need to read a book.
And Manoj, what was your strategy for after November to Feb? What was the strategy for starting and all? Like, how did you use to manage? Like, what kind of tests did you appear in?
So from first week of November, there was I stopped reading new concepts. Okay, no more reading new concepts. This is the time I revised everything what I have covered till now. And by that time, I have forgotten most of the things I read in June, July. What I read, I'd forgotten most of the things. So initially, because I made fair notes when I was building the concepts, I went to those notebooks. I read them again. And because the notes are already there, it doesn't take much time. So I went through all my notes again. Then instead of solving lots of exercise problems, I picked up 1, 2, 3 difficult exercise problems and then solved them and just to revise, refresh my mind on, okay, how does this problem work and how does the solution work, procedure work? And
I will add a few more things, Palak. We in December and January, we run test series for subject wise, module wise and full syllabus exam.
Yeah.
So he was very good in writing those exams regularly. And on top of that, he also joined some other test series called Gating in Aerospace.
Yeah.
And so, he has written every exam.
After you revise the topic, you need, I attended all, most of the mock tests again, topic mock tests that I had covered earlier. I again attempted most of them. All of them because the time was constrained because I haven't had to move to subject level mock tests. So I just did most of the mock tests, topic level mock tests individual. Then I moved to subject level mock tests and daily I was taking one test. Of course, I did badly in a lot of them, most of them. So the next, after the 3 hours test that I used to take in the morning, the afternoon will be spent analyzing what I had failed. What I failed to do or what I could not solve. The evening time, I would be, rereading those concepts that I could not solve in the morning. Night time, I would spend doing aptitude, mathematics and aptitude. Have two people raising hands. How do you? Does that help you?
Thanks, Manoj.
Ashlesh and Arjun, you guys can ask one by one.
Hi Manoj, this is Ashlesha.
Yeah,
actually, I wanted to ask something. You said that you changed your you are doing your master's in aerospace now. So even I am from mechanical and I'll be writing great mechanical. So am I not is it not possible that if I write great mechanical, I can apply to courses that concerns aerospace?
Definitely, you can. In fact, I think every department, every aerospace department will have a quota for mechanical engineers. A lot of, sizable 30% of our batch is mechanical gate people. They're mechanical engineers. They wrote mechanical gate and they got admitted to aerospace department. You see, it's the mother branch is mechanical in aerospace, right? You talk about structures, talk about fluid dynamics, and you talk about propulsion, thermodynamics. It's a mechanical subject. So aerospace is something, it's not a branch. It's like an amalgamation of a lot of branches. In a vehicle engineering, you will have people from mechanical. Okay. You have people from electronics and electrical. You have people from computer science. You have people from mathematics. You have people from physics working on the same aerospace problems because it's an amalgamation of a lot of disciplines. So you are always encouraged to apply. And because you'll be picking aerospace, that's a more niche domain within mechanical. So you'll be focused on a certain set of problems. But apart from that, the fundamental stays same. And a lot of mechanical engineers switch to aerospace. I'm currently working in something that is in the intersection of mechanical and computer science.
Okay.
So that's nothing that I have done before. At least in chemical engineering, if I'm from a chemical engineering, the domain I'll pick within aerospace is propulsion. Or I switch to something else because that's what I wanted to do. And yes, you're free to pick. And every department will consider mechanical, even electrical also.
Oh. And is the marks what we need to get in gate? Is it too high? Can you tell an average marks or something? Is there an average mark for getting into good institutions? I was particularly aiming for IISc or IIST for this.
So I am not exactly aware of the stats that the cutoff that we require for a mechanical engineer who require for admission to aerospace. I think they look at score. So rank is not immaterial. Rank is, you know, immaterial. They look at score. I think that they want a score above 800 in your respective gate paper. Above 800 would be, I'm not sure. Above 900 is very safe. Above 900 means you'll get through. Above 850 is, above 800, I can't say for sure. But all I can say is above 850 or something, you are safe to get in.
Okay. And the other thing is like, it has been a gap that I have started preparing for GATE, because before this I was considering MS and it has been a long time. So I started brushing up the concepts, and now like when I start solving questions, like I sometimes lose track of time. So then I get a little bit nervous, like is there any
strategy? No. Like now it's you take as much time as possible when you are solving questions now, because it's May, it's not September. You know, now is not the time you want to keep track of time.
Yes.
Now, at this point, your sole focus, I know my sole focus at this point of time was to, you know, solve the problem, getting past the first hurdle. Timekeeping will come later. Timekeeping will come after you have, I'm like, solved that class of problems for, you know, 7-8 times. I know what the problem is. Now I know the sort of problem. Let's speed it up. But first, my focus was to attack the problem. Certain things in mechanical, I think you have SFD BMD, right? The beam bending part.
Yes.
It was new to me completely. So I spent, you know, 5-6 days just trying to understand what's going on, drawing diagrams. I have chemical engineering completely reaction, mostly reaction based in mathematics. There was no geometrical or visual parts are not there. Most of the time in chemical engineering. So the visual part was what I was enjoying. And so these problems, I took a lot of time to just figure out. Month of May, June, I'll just spend lots of days just figuring out how to solve this problem. But after the solution is done, okay, this is how you go through it. This is how. It became easier after you understand. So then maybe, you know, in July, August, or maybe September, you can start thinking about, okay, how to speed up my solution process.
Yes. And did you have a specific timeline that this much time you will have for like covering all the topics, and then the rest of the time like you'll do the revision or stuff like that, like for test series and stuff?
So abstractly, see, it's a huge syllabus. Okay. So abstractly, you do have something in mind. Like, okay, from November, December, January has to be revision mock tests. Up till November, from May, that will be concept building phase and doing everything in between. Now you break it down to something smaller, like, okay, 5 subjects. Then I directly went to UK plan, because from that middle level planning I could not do. But what I was able to do was weekly planning. Every week, every Monday, I'll just plan what I need to do. How many syllabus items I'm ticking off from the GATE syllabus, GATE aerospace. So I pasted a paper, GATE aerospace syllabus paper on the wall, and just ticking off every week. It's just a task list that I'm going through. And every week would be a planning. And I had full trust in my faculty, Dinesh sir, Naim sir, Nitin sir. I had full trust that they will finish the syllabus by November first week. So it was all that I could do. That after November I'll start revision, but before that I just have to do the weekly planning, tick off all the topics that I need to cover, and just stay on track. I did not fall behind. I also did not move ahead. Sometimes I would get this urge of, you know, doing something that has not been covered in class, but I resisted that urge and that I just stick to timeline. Do what was being covered currently in depth. If there was some need, if I do not understand, do not think that I do not understand, I go read extra books, but only when it's necessary. One, I usually would stick to one book, but some people will give different opinion. Okay, you need to read 2 books. That's your call. You know, you can take a call and see how much you have understood, how much more you need to understand to solve your GATE problem from a GATE point of view, basically.
Yeah. Okay. Thank you. So Manoj,
hope that helps.
Yeah. Thanks.
If anybody else has a question, so
some people have raised hand. You can ask them.
Please unmute your mic and just ask questions. This was my 5-day. Plan is very simple. Just keep it. I just kept it simple. And
bro, did you add any pressure from family or relations? And if you had, how did you handle it?
So I had financial pressure from my home. Initially, my parents were against me quitting the job. Because of course, my parents don't understand what I want to do. And daily, what on a daily level, what I'm doing in the office, that's not their concern. So all they see is me having, you know, settled. So in a job. So initially, they were against me quitting the job. But I told them that, okay, this is something that I need to do. I need to sacrifice this many amount of years from my life in getting some further study so as to able to get to a more productive career from my end. Now, and it was, I cannot generalize my case because I was working in a startup. It was very stressful. You know how startups in Bangalore work. So less manpower, a lot of work. So it was stressful, of course, but my parents were initially against it. But again, they said, "What do whatever makes you happy. And then if you can assure us, then you will be settled in, say, maybe next 3 years or something. So that's okay. We can survive." So that was the agreement. That was the, you know, discussion I had with my father. And he was okay with me as long. And in fact, you know, after BTech, it was, for me, it was not a hyping, really hyping job. Actually, the learning factor was much more important at the point of time. Than the salary. So the salary is also not high. Anyway, after master's, you'll get a reasonable, everyone gets a reasonable package. So that's also something that I considered. So my parents were agreeing, were okay with it.
And you got support from your previous job or from home?
Yeah, the previous job was actually about building my financial buffer when I was staying in Bangalore. So I, one thing that helped me was I got a single room PG. I searched beside our coaching itself in Marathali Bridge. I looked up a PG. It was a single room, and that was helped me a lot. I had the entire room for me, so I could study in peace. So the finances part you need to take care of. If you are in a, you know, you're shifting to different city. I was in a completely different city, so I had to take care of the finances. And of course, spend frugally. Don't spend too much.
Yeah.
Hello, sir. Good evening, sir. Are you?
Yeah. Don't call me, sir. Just call me Manoj.
Hey, Manoj.
Yeah. Hi.
Actually, I wanted to ask, like, when we go for M.Tech admissions, so at that time, do they give any preference to the students who have worked in any industry, or just it totally depends on the GATE score? Like, if we have scored good, so we can get a good.
In India, it's completely on GATE score. I don't know whether you look in the background or not, but it's mostly on GATE score. That is the plus point you have.
Okay, because actually I'm in 8th semester right now, so I want to go for higher studies, but right now I'm confused whether I can study along with the job or I can totally focus on studying for the GATE exam only for the next 2021.
Are you on the 8th semester currently?
Yes. Already I'm in 8th semester. I couldn't score much in this 2020 GATE, so I wanted to score a good marks for next 2021.
Okay, so your background is in aeronautical engineering.
Aeronautical, yes.
Okay, so if you feel that you don't need to, you know, dedicate the entire day for starting, because you must be exposed to subjects like propulsion and structures. It's not completely new. So if you think that you don't need the entire day to tackle something, a new mountain, you don't need to climb an entire new mountain, you can continue your job. And that's a less riskier proposition. And
but it's not like that. Any special preferences given to the students who have worked?
No, it's nothing. Like, it's in India. Okay. The education system is based on your, you know, entrance score. So if you so you should be okay.
Okay. Yeah. Thank you so much.
We have a bunch of questions from in the chat. What's your plan after M.Tech? So I'll be joining a job probably. So right now I'm not really sure whether I want a PhD, because I can't understand too much of theoretical stuff if I don't see the practical application. So right now my focus is to just take what I want from the master's degree, and then see how it applies to, you know, an industry. How do actually things work in the industry? Right now we are still on pen, paper based design. Simulation, numerical simulation, but I actually have to see how this works on real life. Only then I can maintain a motivation levels, because PhD is a big commitment. It takes not less than 4 years, or not less than 5 years to actually complete. It's building a theoretical depth, your problem solving abilities. Those things, the willpower will come if I actually see the, you know, some practical application. So right now I plan to join the industry, but in future, I do want to go to PhD, but I'm not sure when.
So after GATE exam, which one is better, master's or direct PhD? See, I cannot give you an opinion on this because I'm not pursuing a PhD. I objectively cannot give a comparison. So you'll need to talk to people who has directly joined PhDs, and you need to give their opinion. You can take my opinion on master's and then you can take a call. So it's completely on you how you want to proceed.
Sir, can you tell about, like, if we apply for some interdisciplinary field, suppose CDS in ISC?
Yeah, I did not apply, but do you want to apply there?
Yes, actually I want to apply in field related to robotics or data science, machine learning. So okay. Currently I am from aerospace background.
Okay.
And in aerospace, I think control GNC domain will relate with this field, but I am not sure exactly what is going to happen in this master's and PhD in GNC.
So
I want to ask if GNC is related, how much related to this ML and all these things, and if not, like, in, if we're planning to apply in interdisciplinary branches, then how we should balance the GATE score and our working experience, like another projects.
Okay, so do you have any work experience on this field?
Actually, I have an internship on automation of drones.
Okay. Yes. So are you currently a student at some university, or are you working?
I just graduated from Punjab Engineering College in aerospace domain only.
Okay.
And I have a 6-month internship in airlines also, working as a data analyst.
Okay.
And 3 months experience in working on automation of drones.
Okay, so I'll just give you a few points that see, GNC is complete traditional aerospace. So GNC has been around since 50s, 1950s, 60s, since missiles were being manufactured. Those were actually the first unmanned aerial vehicles, if you talk it in those terms.
I understand.
So yeah. So GNC is mostly traditional. It's fundamental. It mostly has nothing to do with machine learning as such. It's a new and upcoming field. So if you look at GNC, it's an extension of dynamical systems, your engineering mechanics, and you apply control theory to that, and then try to those are old ways of doing it. The new ways, people are trying to get the model out of the equation and just use a neural network and mod map input outputs. I don't understand it fully, so I cannot give you my comment, but it's a completely radically different field. What I can tell you is what happens in our department. So my guide works in traditional guidance and control, something that has been around since 60s, 70s. It's completely engineering mechanics based, it's control theory based, it's your basic differential equations, your engineering maths based. So that is fairly easy to understand. If you want to apply something like ML to GNC, I do not know how that plays out because I'm still studying. I cannot give you an opinion, but there are a lot of people who are actually applying neural based methods to these GNC problems. Of course, the Kalman filter based sensing, navigation sensor fusion, this has been around for quite a long time now. But the people who work in ML and GNC are mostly a different department. In our college, there's a department called Robert Boss Center for Cyber Physical Systems. Those people work in these interdisciplinary problems. So if you talk about robotics, if you talk about robotics is a different field from GNC. That's something that we will get out of the way. So what this Robert Boss Center is doing is they're trying to apply these ML-based approaches to robotics problems. So that should be something that might be of interest to you. You can of course go to the ISC website, see what Robert Boss Center is doing, and then you can see if some of the problems interest you. I don't know how to take admission. You will need to ask. I'll ask someone from the department. I'll get back to you. So I do not know the admission process or what GATE score, what preference did they get to give to the GATE score. So I'll need to research more on this. Ask around. And GNC is mostly not nothing to do with robotics. I don't work in robotics. I'm a pure flight mechanics guy. So, but there are overlaps. It's all mechanics, right? So you can do something else, but it is over and above what you do in GNC. And coming to CDS, CDS is it's more of a computational department. They do simulations a lot. They just take a physical problem. They use their numerical tools to simulate the problem. I am not aware of any particular person who's doing ML-based work or AI-based work in CDS, but a lot of people are doing. They're applying this. These are all tools, right? You have to remember, always remember that these ML-AI, these are all tools that we apply to certain problems. So in fact, yeah, there are a lot of people working in there, but it is not ML or AI focused. They're actually solving some physical problems. They're applying AI and ML there. And people from all our departments, some mechanical people have joined CDS in computational combustion. Some people are working in computational combustion. Some people are working in CFD. Some other people are working in medical imaging. So lots of interesting problems, but from a computational point of view. So I hope that helps you. I think I could not give you, I'm not exactly aware how ML AI plays into GNC, but I hope this.
Yes, sir. I understand your point. And sir, one more question. Like I want to know about notes making. Like I have some like difficulties while making the notes. Like during the live lecture, notes making is not feasible for me. And after the lecture, I need to spend again 1.5 or 2 hours to prepare the notes. So like my most of the time is going in this note making instead of solving problems. How should I manage this thing?
Okay, in the online, since I was in the classroom, I can't really advise you how to do it online in online lectures. In the classroom, what I used to do is you get some time to make some rough notes. So I used to do rough notes in my notebook, but that is not the ultimate, my ultimate notebook. So if you are able, just take rough notes of what the teacher is speaking. Just write in rough, it doesn't have to be neat and clean and then whatever. Just get a first impression of what the topic is all about. And after that, after the class, of course, you have to read a book. So when you read the book, you open your rough notes, you read the book, then you see does this call it the class notebook and the book. And then you form some opinion extracted from the book and the class notebook, and then you make your fair notebook. You have to invest that time. Making a notes is such a crucial thing in preparation. And later on when you revise, you can't go to your book and to read because there will be so much information. So in fair notebook will be a summarized version of the topics that you have in your book. And I have also emphasized in the previous video also that I did, I have emphasized the process of diagram making. Dinesh sir was talking to you in the starting about 3D, three-dimensional machinery assemblies that you need to draw in engineering drawing. Those drawings, just roughly drawing, going through the process of drawing in your notebook is very crucial. In aerodynamic, you are from aeronautical background, right?
Yes, sir.
Yeah, so in aerodynamics, you have thin airfoil theory. You need to draw this cutter condition at the end of the airfoil, and you have to see how these vortices form at the end of the airfoil. So without diagrams, it's impossible to understand. So you do need to make diagrams. So in the fair notebook, you get a chance to fully focus on the diagram making process and just understand how the physics is playing out. So when you're doing the online lecture, don't spend too much of time. In classroom, I did not spend too much effort trying to make good notes. Just captured whatever in quickly. I just captured whatever the sir is saying, and I had to capture all of the things that the teacher was saying. So it cannot be. It's mostly impossible to be neat and clean. So just capture what the teacher is saying, understand the lecture, and now since online, you can pause and replay also after the video is recorded, and then go back and read a book. Book reading is very essential, and note making is very essential.
I will add Lokesh on this. I previously, when you asked this query to me, I have referred him only, Manoj, because what I have seen, the best notes for you is prepared by yourself. Because exactly. Down the line, you will not have time to read books, especially 1 month before exam or 2 months before exam. So if you do good practice of making good notes now itself, it will save a lot of time down the line for you to revise quickly, okay? In the less time, more things. So don't worry, as of now, it may take some amount of time from you instead of practicing more problem. Okay, let it do it. Okay,
yeah, don't make worry your about best it.
Note. Yeah, because see, there are two important factors. One is a learning concept well, and second is practice. So both has to be balanced. And initial days, concept learning is more important than just practicing. Okay.
Fully so, agreed, sir. Fully agreed.
Yeah, so just don't worry about that, okay? Yeah, and keep putting efforts, okay? If you put efforts every day, sufficient efforts, what has been done in a week time, and then nothing to worry. Because, see, this learning and preparing well is not overnight job, okay? For any competitive exam, either it is GATE or before that, you guys might have prepared for JEE and other exams, okay? So it's like a cumulative effort of minimum 6 to 8 months, 1 year. For some people, it is 2 years if it is a JEE exam, okay? So just keep doing it consistently. It will work well, okay? You will get lot of time when you have everything, you are thorough with concept, okay? It will work. Yeah, Manoj, you can
go. Yeah, just trust the classroom sequence. I cannot speed up my area. Everyone has their own learning speed, and you cannot speed it up. Or you can speed it up, you can try, but I can't, you know, if somebody gives me a topic like, say, second order differential equations, you have to understand what the thing is, what that represents, how it works in real life, how do you use that concept, what are the solution procedure. It's impossible for me to do it in like one day. So I have to take my time. So give yourself time, be, you know, kind to yourself. If you think you're taking a lot of time in note making, don't be harsh. Just do it. Don't have second thoughts. Just make the notes and understand. The goal is to understand. Then later, this is not a gate affair. You will later also you'll need all these concepts. So,
like if we are clear with the concepts in the classroom only, do we still need to refer textbooks and all?
Yeah, you have to. Especially for me when I was. This was a new subject for me. Aerodynamics was a new subject for me. So classroom, of course, it's about, you have a coconut, you want to crack it. So the first hard blow that can give you is a classroom. But even then, if the coconut doesn't break, you have to read something extra. So the final point is, it has to be both. Like, you have to do the classroom, but you also have to read the book. It will enrich you, and it will help you solve the problems. Ultimately, you have to, in a gate point of view, you have to solve the problem. So you have to have as much firepower in your mind to be able to crack it. So yes, the book reading, I think, is very essential. For me, reading Anderson, Fundamentals of Aerodynamics was a very enriching experience. Apart from, in addition to what I was doing in class. Because in classroom, if the book will have lots of material, I don't know what to read. But in the classroom, when the teacher is teaching, he will go through a sequence of topics. You lay it down, and then I can, okay, this is a sequence I need to study. Then I'll go to the book and just repeat the sequence, but in more detail, of course.
And also, this class gives the idea what has to study, because knowledge is infinite, okay, and we have limited time. So from gate perspective and a little bit above and little bit below, we should always study. Previously also we have come across such questions. So we say, of course, you should study little more than what is required. So definitely you can solve easy problem, okay, with much more comfort. So that's the whole idea.
Yeah, in fact, this is a skill. This is, I consider this a skill. Reading books, reading some material, or maybe online, or absorbing material if you don't feel confident in a certain topic. In fact, you need this skill when you go to masters. In masters, we are so, I always tell the students that we are so fortunate that we in GATE, everything was structured. The teacher will just teach and I'll just go home and do it. No background management, nothing required. Just diligently work it out. Here, when you get to masters, nobody is even giving you that. It's completely, you know, out in scattered, it's like spaghetti. Nobody's helping you. Nobody's telling you what to do. So first you have to figure out what to do. And then you have to figure out how to do it. So there is a double level effort. So not only have you to figure out what things do I need to do to get to this level in my project, but also on top of that, you need to read books. So that is master's, that is, you know, PhD or say master's, you know, you need to explore on your own. So I think this skill is very important.
Good. And sir, like, which book will you recommend for propulsion?
For propulsion, see, for basic thermodynamics, I refer to Moran and Shapiro.
Lokesh, one moment, I will interrupt. This information we can give further. Okay.
Yeah, yeah. It's there on the website.
If you want to be a more generalized, he will definitely help. And in his Quora answer, he has written, I have shared with you. So please go through. Yeah. Sure. Others can ask generalized questions because we are already closing time. Yeah, you can.
Yeah, I have one more question in chat.
Thank you.
Yeah, sure.
How you tackled the core aerospace subjects when you started reading first? So I did not start with core aerospace subjects. I started with basic subjects. So I did not go jump into aerodynamics directly. It was Naeem sir's fluid mechanics class that I attended first. And I went back and read FM White's fluid mechanics, the basic parts up till the integral conservation equations, differential conservation equations, dimensional analysis. Before that, you have to cover something like static, hydrostatics, fluid properties, those things before jumping into aerodynamics. And same goes for other subjects as well. Yeah, hi, I'm able to hear you.
Yes, sir. In a day, how many subjects you put efforts means it's only one subject or basically one or two subjects you...
Per day, I'll only keep one subject because it's very...
Okay, means one subject you study the concepts well and later on you go to next subject.
Yeah, later. It's something like in morning I'll read the topic and afternoon or evening I'll start working on the problem. But per day, I'll just keep one subject. Actually, I need a break of one night's break between switching between subjects. And for me, context switching was not something productive. So I'll just stick to one subject. After I sleep, take a one night sleep. Maybe then I can move to next subject after mind is fresh.
Okay, so it will be helpful means if I do means one day one subject only means one chapter I will do and after that all the numericals of the chapter. That will be good.
Navanko, I will add one point. See, you can study multiple subjects. But make sure whenever you study, make sure any subject you study minimum 2 to 3 hours. Anyone should never plan study of 1 hour. 1 hour you will not going to do anything. Okay, so whenever you study in a stretch 2 to 3 hours. So that will give you some kind of output. Either it is one subject in a one day or a multiple subject. But anytime if you plan studies, make sure study minimum 2 to 3 hours.
Yeah, and also you have to take some minor breaks, 5 minutes break after each hour to be able to keep on track. Otherwise, I used to lose focus if I do everything in stretch. So one, say if you 40 minutes, I'll absorb some part of the chunk, take a 5 minute break, refresh, get out of the chair, desk and table. And in fact, in that break, I used to go outside and think what I had just done. I would ruminate about, what I have just done, just revise in my head. So that break is very crucial to be able to solidify concepts. And then you go back, then let's do the next concept or just revise the concept that I've done in the previous 40, 50 minutes.
Hello, sir.
Yeah, hi.
Yeah, hello, sir. I'm Himanshu and I found you over the YouTube and saw your video. So it's truly inspiring that being a non-aerospace guy, you write a GATE aerospace exam and excel in that exam. So, sir, what do you want to give your suggestion for the non-aerospace candidates? Like, how should they approach towards these aerospace subjects? And at what level? Like, so far, basically, this aerospace and mechanicals have some common subjects. Mm-hmm. And what happens in after due course of action that since you are going to learn this aerospace subject for the first time, so you don't want to refer book and because time is so short and you have to cover all the things at the same time. So what is your advice on that? that non-aerospace guy, how should he learn aerospace subjects?
Okay, which department are you from and which gate paper are you
from? Mechanical.
Okay, and you're...
I'm from mechanical, but writing aerospace.
Okay, so there's nothing much I can add. It's just the generic things that I have spoken a bit before. Do the classroom notes and then read the book. Other than that, I do not know what special formula. I did not follow any other special formula. It's just the same routine. You have to read a book. You cannot skip reading a book. This is the only source of information you'll get. You can get it online.
Himanshu, okay. I will add on this point. What he followed the subject sequence, okay? Like, he first went to basic subjects and then slowly he moved to core. What happens, many people directly jump to core subjects and all core are derived from basics. So they will be lagging in basics and then they will do mesh, complete mesh. So that should not be the case. If you go systematic approach, it works. And that's what I have observed in case of Manoj. Prior to Manoj, I have taught to computer science engineer, aerospace engineering. I have struggled a lot. The reasons were they were not regular. So both people were working. Okay. But one guy is still got qualified. Okay. He was so enthusiastic. Now he's in Germany pursuing masters in aerospace. So it's again depends on the individual, how they take up this challenge. Okay. So at personal level, from my observation with Manoj, I will say be more and more systematic in your approach. So in less time, you can do more.
Basics has to come out. And I think since you have a mechanical background, I don't think that learning solid mechanics will be a challenge because you have done it before. Or fluid mechanics, up till incompressible flow, most of the mechanical curriculum will have it. Thermodynamics also is a common subject. So those are the things I did before jumping. I did not jump after propulsion. So in propulsion, initially, propulsion subject will start after you finish thermodynamic cycles. So propulsion is what? Like in engine, you just do a thermodynamic cycle analysis. The cycle concept comes from basic thermodynamics. So you have to understand like Carnot cycle, and then you have Lenoir cycle. Right. And
yeah, because if this approach is definitely more scientific and more logical towards learning. But the thing is, like, once you are learning any subject for first time, so at you have a phobia inside at for starting point of phase.
Yeah.
So this is quite natural. So like once you start learning and you have so much to do, then there is some corner in your mind that you are skipping your way, you know, once basic subject is finished, then you are starting the aerospace subject, then you just sail. It cannot be done thoroughly like university students usually do.
Patience has to be, you have to keep a lot of patience in learning that duration. It is just matter of just 2 to 3 months. If you keep your patience and keeping your efforts on, it works.
See, okay.
I will give one example of Manoj. You know, many aerospace engineer neglect unsymmetrical bending part, thin walled structure part. But this, he was the one guy, though he was not from aero background, that part is very complicated. In gate, they just ask one or two questions, but he has learned completely. Even watching the videos of UNSW and attending my all classes, solving each problem. So it's, again, you have to keep your patience to learn that well.
Yes, sir.
Yeah, it's a new topic. You just take it sportingly. It's a new topic I have to cover. And it's no point getting scared. That I did not make any comparison that university people have it better than me because they had some background. That's not how it works. So first thing is, you don't have to be stopped being afraid. Stop the fear from getting to you. That yes, it's a natural thing to be afraid of new things, but you have to first thing know, I'll do this, I can do this. And the first thing you do is when you see what Suresh said, like in thin wall torsion, the Bredberg theory, and it's a very complicated topic. So don't, I did not expect success in like first attempt. Okay, I have this problem, I help to solve it today. That's not how I did it. I just, you know, first slowly, patiently understood what's going on. Okay, this is the physics, this is this diagram, this is the procedure. Okay, if I follow this procedure, slowly it took me maybe a week maybe to grasp the theory of the process. But then after you go through that, you know, that step, you'll be able to yourself understand. You will not believe it that yes, one week back I was thinking I could not solve it, but now after I have gone through the process, I'm not able to solve it. So first thing is don't let fear get to you. And number two is be open-minded on the problem and don't expect immediate results. Like I will solve this problem immediately. No, that's for me it was impossible. Some people might crack my problem in one day itself. It's just extremely good, but that's not the cool case with everyone.
Right. Yes. So, sir, that was my concern. Like, because you formally not introduced with the aerospace core subjects. Yeah, I mean, basically, basic subjects can be, we can fight over it and we can put battle on. But for the core subjects, since you know you are not formally introduced, so it quite phobia inside, actually.
Yeah. So I'll tell you. I'll type in with one more point about this. See, this fear of new things went away when I was working in the job. So now that I think about it, when I see a complicated topic, I have faced this situation before. When I was working in a job, it is very complicated, and I've never. So when people do MBA and they go to management, like immediately after BTEC they go MBA and they go join some management field, they're seeing entirely new problems altogether. It has nothing to do with their education. So how do you learn everything online, onboard the knowledge of the project on the moment itself, and then you apply to solve it? That's something like Jugaad approach, you say. Say I'm learning on the job itself and then I'm applying it. That's what I need in my job, and that's what I carried over to my preparation.
So like, what I felt is so far preparing the exam, like there are two types of preparation. First is thorough approach. Usually the holistic student used to apply. And the second one is the patchwork approach, like what is required, that's only needed to be learned and
see practiced. Patchwork might or might not get you through GATE, but it definitely don't get you through masters, because masters is a different ball game. You have to do projects. Patchwork learning will not help you complete projects at all. It's
yeah, exactly. I'm not feel comfortable with patchwork type of approach. So that is my point. Like aerospace subjects, this patchwork, I think I would be able to understand, but I won't be feeling confident because I know my insight that something
later also you'll need the same skill. So it's better that you get acquainted early on rather than trying to fight later and giving yourself the chance. Why, you know, take risks? Why do patchwork and take risks? Just do the full thing, and you know later on it will help you also. And in, you know, when you go, you have to go to industry at some point of time. You have to do some work. What will you do then? So you have to. You know,
yes, a patchwork is more. It's more convincing.
It's something that we do in the semesters, in like university semesters. What I used to do is I would do the previous year's papers and then go to semester. That's not how real world works. You know.
Right. Okay, sir. So that was my doubt. Yeah. Thank you, sir. Thanks.
Yeah, you're welcome.
Hi, Manoj.
Yeah. Hi.
Yes, sir. My question is regarding a future prospect, actually. Like aerospace industry, if you see, is also sidelined with like almost close to like defense. So it is actual implications of aerospace, like outside in Collins Aerospace or something like that.
In India, this is a career part was not something that I really thought about when I was writing, because I was so overcome with like I want to do this, so I did not even think about what the career prospects was. But those definitely would come back to haunt me. So in India, the aerospace core work is very less scope compared to something like, say, even mechanical. Compared to mechanical, aerospace work is very less in India. And most of the aircraft companies will work in structures. Aerodynamics or CFD, something of that sort. So
yeah,
In India, the aerospace industry is like, in even in abroad, compared to something like electrical design or software engineering, so aerospace work is heavily invested in defense. So the prospects are generally less. So, but your master's education is so general that you can, of course, join a mechanical company. That's what most of the people do in our batch. Aerospace jobs are not there. So they join a mechanical company because they have the training in it. So since it's, you see, if you go abroad in US, it's, US is invest a lot of things in defense, and aerospace is mostly interlinked with defense, and they will need a lot of security clearances to for you. So it's very, quite impossible. You cannot work in some role that requires security clearance and US citizenship. That's impossible. So a lot of roles are like cut off from you. So the prospects generally are less. That's not something to be feeling disheartened about. So because you can go, you know, work in a mechanical role. And for me specifically, where I am working, I work in flight software, flight control plus flight software. So there's a high chance, there's in fact a 98% chance that I will not work in a flight control or flight software role. But since I'm getting some training in software engineering, I'm eligible for software jobs. Guaranteed, most people are not working in core flight software, but you do get jobs somewhere, right? So, but you have to work hard. So software is something that is taught in core aerospace. There's already a lot of things to teach. So that's something you have to hustle about. You have to hustle. Like I am studying data structures and algorithms. It's a core computer science subject. Numerical methods, it's a CDS subject. So these things I'm picking because I need them in my core aerospace work later on if I do. But they will also help me get a job if I don't get a core aerospace job. So there are opportunities, not within the aerospace domain, but outside a lot. So if you hustle and then if you work hard, then you will get a role.
Okay. Because I was doing some research, so like even outside the country, it's like there are ITR restrictions or something like that.
Yeah, the ITR restriction is there. That is the basically you need security clearance for working in a US-based aerospace firm. That's impossible unless you stay there for 10 years and you get a green card. And that's a Herculean task. So, okay, that's mostly impossible. So you have to look at something like civilian aircraft companies or up and coming. These UAV companies are, UAV market is very lucrative, or unmanned aerial vehicles. So that's where GNC kicks in. So this is up and now, especially in light of this pandemic, a lot of people are researching on how to use drones for delivery, you know, contactless delivery and some sort. And there, you know, flight software, GNC is very important. So yes, there are roles, there are opportunities.
Thank you.
Hi, yeah.
Hi, sir.
Yeah, hello.
Sir, I want to ask a question that what are the chances of researching in the rocket propulsion in India?
In India, see, I cannot specifically give you. In our department, there are two or three professors working in rocket propulsion. Rocket propulsion in the sense that they're working combustion. So that's common to both aircraft propulsion and rocket propulsion.
Okay.
Regarding opportunities in the other IITs, I think you will need to contact someone from there. I am not sure what goes on there. But okay. Yes, rocket propulsion is something you will mostly be working in combustion or, you know, maybe a hybrid form of propulsion like electric propulsion, Hall effect thrusters or something. Those are upcoming technologies you can always research. I'm not sure because I'm not in that domain. But yes, there's work going on.
Yeah. Thank you, sir.
Manoj, I want to just add on to that actually. Like, I was checking on ionic propulsion systems, like, and I only saw the tab in IESC, that research available. Like, considering like your experience, like, do you have any other idea, like, where exactly is it being?
I don't have much idea about it. Ionic propulsion is something that is used in spacecraft. It's not a. It cannot be scaled up to something like a rocket. It's still chemical propulsion is the way to go, given the amount of thrust required. But in spacecraft, they are looking, you know, efficient modes of attitude control systems. So we even need small thrusters to readjust your attitude or the orientation of the spacecraft. And there are these small, highly efficient thrusters are very helpful. Are something that we call as RCS, reaction control systems. So yeah, there's a lot of work going on. I am not aware because I'm not directly involved with the field, but maybe, you know, if you look online or just look into professors' profiles, if you go to some IIT or ISC website and then check out the profiles of professors, you'll definitely find a lot more information than what I can give.
Okay, thank you.
Yeah.
So while you were preparing, were you focused 100% only on GATE syllabus, or were you following any daily news, politics like that?
No, I was fully focused on GATE syllabus. See, this is one question that I have, that I'd like to point out, that you have to, the more you eliminate distractions, the better for you. Because ultimately, if you give into distractions, all they are taking is, they are taking away useful time from your preparation, and they are not giving you any output. So, you're in engineering, right? So, you're in engineering, if you're in engineering, you try to build something, you try to give some input and get some output out of it. So, you have to think from an engineering point of view. Okay, is this utilitarian, what I'm doing right now, is it utilitarian or is it not? If you ask that question, it's going to be a very difficult question for a lot. For me also, it's a lot difficult. For social media,
I turned off. But I think I should be aware of my surroundings, what's happening.
A lot of people used to call me autistic because I'm not aware of my surroundings. But that's okay. You know, for 1 year, you can make the sacrifice. This is the part where, you know, you have to take some strong decisions. Because if you're not aware of my surroundings, you're not going to die. That's for sure. You're still living. All you need is, you know, daily food, the feed and food you need, and you need sleep. And then that's all you need to. You just focus on, don't give to distractions, because that's not productive. And later on, it will harm you. It will harm your performance. So if you're doing one thing, do it straight. Do it well. That's my message. Because what I was doing is, I was completely cut off from the outside world. I was just not completely cut off. That's very best.
Focused on them gates.
Yeah. So this is one more important thing I want to say, is every Saturday, Sunday, when you have classes, take a break. So entire weekday, from Monday I'll start studying, but Friday I'll be fed up. Okay, this is too much, I can't take it anymore. But Friday night, I just, okay, I can't take it anymore. I need to take a break, substantial break. The next day, I'll just sleep for some time, break my mind afresh. Saturday, I'll do the entire class, understand everything, take all notes, capture all notes. In the evening, I'll take a break, I'll visit a friend's house. And Saturday night, from the evening and Sunday night, I will not touch my books. That break is very important. That is very important for keeping your mental balance. And that's, for me, that was sufficient. I did not need any other more, you know, breaks. That was sufficient for me. Saturday, Sunday, complete break. You relax, you talk to friends, you go to a friend's place and you watch some movies. I have a lot of friends here who are working in Bangalore's companies, and I just crash in their places and then watch so movie with them, and that's a pretty refreshing experience. And on weekdays, you get back to your work. That's it.
Thanks.
Hello, sir.
Yeah, hi.
Hi, sir. Sir, what was your revision strategy during preparation?
So, in a nutshell, what I did in preparation was, after October end, say November 1st week or 2nd week, my entire concept, all the syllabus concepts were over. So, then by then I had forgotten a lot of things from, you know, what I studied in May, June, July. I forgot a lot of maths. I forgot, you know, linear algebra, then differential equations, complex variables. So those things, what I did was, first thing, just go through the fair notes that you have made quickly, so that you feel confident again. Okay, this was the thing. You revise everything from the fair notebook, pick up a few exercise problems from those topics from the book, solve them, and then go to the mock test. The topic of wise mock test in your portal. So just reattempt them. Don't worry about performance. I used to fail a lot of mock tests again after, you know, let's say in a few mock tests I'd score 60-70% initially. Then when I was revising, I'm scoring like 40% again. Okay, that shouldn't be a cause of concern. You, again, it's about revision. You, after you give the exam again, you revise the topic again. So just go through a fair notebook. It will save you a lot of time. You will also understand a lot of quickly, and attempt the mock test and analyze what you have left, what you could not attempt in the mock test, and then go through the loop again until you are sure that, okay, I have understood this again. If you do this like twice or thrice, that concept will be permanently set in your mind.
Okay, sir. So, sir, you started after October, November, mock test.
Yeah. No, the topic was mock test. I was doing daily. After completion of every topic.
Okay. Topic was almost weekly.
Yeah, almost weekly. I'll attempt, say I'd complete 3 topics per week. So I'll attempt 3 topic quiz mock quiz. That is always going continuously. But on a broader level, I finished all the learning, all the concepts by the end of October. A few topics were left from, say, flight dynamics, a few topics were left. Modes of aircraft, Fuego, short period, and those things. And then a few things from vibration was left. Okay. But by that time, I had finished most of the syllabus. By that time, I had attempted all of the topic mock tests at least once.
So by the end of October, November, you have completed your class notes and assignments, all the assignments, and regarding their mock tests.
Yeah, assignments I could not solve all because of time constraint. Work it out how you want to.
So sir, like
assignments, most of the them are solved. Some very lengthy or very lengthy.
Yeah.
Few assignments.
Yeah, hello. Hello.
Yeah. Hi.
Hello, sir. So basically, sir, you are in IISc now.
Yeah. Yeah. Hi. Yeah. That's true.
So, sir, how do you feel? What is the requirement of marks to get into IISc?
I think above 850 score should be safe enough to get into IISc. But the program is not much different from what you see in IITs. You'll be studying the same subjects. You will get the same opportunities. And the only thing is there is no bachelor's department here. So you won't have a TA duty. But other than that, mostly is the... Here's a research... It's a research institution. So a lot of people doing cutting edge research. In IITs...
What is the difference it makes from IIT, sir? Basically, IISc?
In my program, it doesn't make a difference. It's very flexible. You can... I do not know about IITs. Need to ask other people, but in my department you are very flexible about choosing your courses. So this semester I'm picking courses, one from instrumentation department and one from CBS and two from my department. Next semester I'm going to pick all subjects from CBS department. So you have the flexibility. I think IITs also have this, that you can pick up.
Getting into IITs is easy after GATE, or IISc is difficult for getting? Pursuing M.
See, there are a lot of top rankers who go to IITs. So there is no conclusive opinion I can give, or rather a difficulty level. I think it's...
The score level will be low for as compared to IISc, sir, in IITs?
Okay. So IISc is, if you're above 850, you're in. If you are not above, say, 750 or something, and you don't get into IISc, you go into IIT, that's not, you know, the score is not a basis of difference, because ultimately you're working in the same program. So whether you're an aerospace program in IIT Kanpur or an aerospace program in IISc Bangalore, IIT Bombay, the programs are same. What you learn is important, and the score is just how to manage people.
So, sir, one question to ask, sir.
Yeah.
It will be good to choose a dual program if anyone goes to IITs or IISc, means MS plus PhD both.
See, I cannot. It's completely up. Depends on the individual. It depends on what decision. I cannot give you a general thing. For me, combined MS PhD is not feasible, because just giving GATEs does not make me an aerospace engineer, right? So I have to spend some time getting into the understanding field. So directly PhD after MS for me is not feasible. I need some more time. That's also a good thing to, you know, and a way for me to get into the industry and see what things are going on. But eventually I'll go for PhD. It's completely your call. It's an individual's call. Whether they are willing to do MS PhD together, whether they will be able to commit to such a length of time, or whether just MTech, that's completely an individualistic decision.
Okay, sir. Thank you, sir.
If you have any more questions, then yeah.
Yes, sir. Sir, actually, I was in between, so I will continue my thing. I wanted to know that started to give the mock test, you prepared a little bit about before giving mock test, right?
Yeah, yeah. Or, we have to prepare.
Or have you completed all the, you know, assignments and all stuffs?
So this was my sequence. First, I read the no class notes and then make my fair notebook. That is the concept building part. Then some exercise problems, solve problems, exercise problems from the book. That will give me an idea of how to attack the problem. Then assignments, of course, as many problems I can solve. Ideally, I solve most assignments, all problems. After that, I'll go for mock test. Before that, I did not have the confidence to attempt mock test without solving the assignment. Because first, I need some practice, right? You need practice. So the assignments give you good practice for the mock test.
So is it, this is not necessary that like all assignments should be completed first before applying mock tests?
Sometimes
you have to, you know, keep your momentum with classes and all progression. So you don't want
you have to see, you have behind, to play it out how it works. Because assignments, some assignments, like in my thermodynamic cycle assignment, if I remember properly, it was very lengthy. And some problems are repetitive. So it's your smart call. Take a call. Like, problem number 4, 5, 6 are on thermodynamic cycle, combined cycles. I don't need to do all of them. I need to do 2 of them out of 4. So you do 2.
Okay.
You will get to understand the class of problems. So basically, your idea is to solve a class of 2 problems from the class of problems and then get an idea how this general class works.
All right.
Yes,
sir. Please go ahead.
So that's applicable to almost all subjects, even for other departments also. If you're in computer science or somebody's in computer science, you can just go through some algorithm and then try to solve it in hand. Solve 2 problems from the general set of problems and then you'll be able to tackle all of them. You'll know how it works.
Okay. So to balance it out, like you can say like at least 1 or 2 assignment, 2-3 assignment maximum, you should complete before applying mock test so that you can at least tackle the problem in the test.
That's the idea.
Okay, sir. Yeah, that was my actually recurring problem. Thank you, sir.
Hope that helps. If anyone else has some question, you can please shoot.
Yeah, hello, sir.
Hi.
Yeah, hi there. Sir, how about planning the subject, one single subject for a complete month? It means like if I'm planning for the structures, then under the structures, there are some subjects like SOM, aircraft structures, and which includes vibrations also. If I combine all those 3 subjects as a structured one, can I complete it in 1 month? Is that the right schedule can be completed like one subject for one?
Hello?
Every subject in 1 month is good, or we have to split the subjects?
So it's quite difficult to club everything in one go and then giving and making a statement and these 3 subjects I need to do in 1 month. That's very very difficult call. In fact, that's not what I did. It would be very difficult for me if I was doing it. This is where you know the I completely trusted the classroom sequence. I just knew, I'll go through the flow. I'll go through what class topics I've been doing. I'll just cover them as they come. And then at some point of time, the structures will be over. And then I can see, I've covered structures. Solid mechanics. Let's pick out one chapter from solid mechanics, your initial elastic theory. So you might be, you know, very ecstatic. I have to finish SOM within this time. But when you start running elastic theory, you will see that, it is taking a lot of time. Then you are conflicted. I had to finish the entire subject in 2 weeks, but elastic theory itself is taking a lot of time. So it generates conflict in your mind. So I'll suggest not to think that way, that you have, don't give a strict deadline, especially in months of May and June, don't give deadlines that I have to finish this. Give time to your concept, elastic theory. I'll complete it as much time as it takes now. I'll give it, I'll understand it. Let it take its own due time. Trust the process. Instead, if you end up taking 1.5 months for covering SOM or some other, I'm taking hypothetically, but say you take 2 months for covering SOM, it should not be a concern, because you at the end you ended up learning all the concepts. So the goal is to understand the concept. Now if you start squeezing in, it might not play out, because a lot of times we try to keep more in our plate than we can chew. That's a common human characteristic. You are so ambitious, you keep everything on one plane and try to do it all. That's something, most of the time it doesn't work that way. You can't like do everything. You can't build something in one day. So you let it take its time and then just go through the process.
Okay, sir. Okay, sir. Sir, any suggestion or planning regarding the subjects, like when should be all completed, or any suggestion of the learning subjects in order in a sequential way? Any suggestions, sir?
So, as far as sequences go, if before you do jet propulsion, you need to understand thermodynamics. So, every four core subjects will have four separate parts, but you can do, say you want to do thermodynamics and fluid dynamics on the same week, you can do it. Those are parallel channels. Fluid dynamics, so your solid mechanics is not required for thermo-based subjects, right? So you can do them parallelly, but within those channels you need to follow the sequence. So that's the thing I did. And by the you should be able to finish, ideally if you finish by second week of November, that should be fine. 2 months revision is sufficient enough if you follow the routine, a revision routine.
Oh, okay, fine, sir. Sir, how many hours should we spend each day averagely for the gate preparation?
So this is a question. I cannot really answer in quantitative terms, because what I used to do was, since I was studying full time and I was completely dedicated to preparation, I would usually end up spending around 9 to 10 hours per day on an average. Sometimes I'd study for 2 hours some days. Say on Thursday, Friday, my productivity will be very low because I have been intensely studying for Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday. So Monday, Tuesday, I'll be studying like 9, 10, 11 hours. It depends on my energy level. On Friday, I would still try to push, get something out of the Friday, but it's simply a little unproductive than the other day. Say I'll be studying 3-4 hours. So, but one thing was, if I did not think in that way, I have to study 9 hours per day. Just sometimes it's just not possible. And moreover, when you are preparing, don't think about time. Just make sure you get up from your desk from after one hour. And until you understand the topic, keep going at it. Don't think that, okay, 9 hours I have to study, and after 9 hours is done, I'm done. No. If you have the energy, you can carry on for 11 hours. If you don't have the energy, maybe 3 hours, if you can pull, that's great. That's great. So don't monitor time. When you, especially in May, June, July, August, don't monitor time, daily time, how much you're logging. That's not something that helped me. I did not monitor time at all. I just focused on how to understand this concept and how to solve this problem. That was the only goal. Some day it took me a lot of time, some day it took me less time. That's fine.
Okay. Happy. Thank you.
I hope that helps.
Yeah, sure, sir. Thank you.
After a topic, were you solving assignment problems only, or previous year question papers also?
I solved both. I solved both. I solved previous question grade papers. I solved when I thought I'm ready to solve this paper.
From start only.
Yeah, from starting and
after a topic. Yeah.
Yeah. So I think I started solving grade papers on the month of July, because that's when I started gaining a substantial level of concepts, and then but of course some advanced topics I had to leave out from the gate paper, so I just marked them in a gate paper. But whatever else I could solve, I solved it as much as possible. So just get myself acquainted on what were being asked in the previous year's papers. And I think by the end of third week of October, I was solving the full gate papers. So by the time I used to time myself from the third week of November on the gate papers. So that's something you can do. You can time yourself on the previous year's gate papers.
Yeah. Thank you.
Yeah, you're welcome. So if you guys have any more questions, I will be happy to take them. I just wanted to know if anyone has any more questions. Otherwise, we can leave the meeting. We can schedule more sessions later on when everyone's free.
Yes, sir. It was so nice and so inspirational and motivational talking with you.
Yeah, thank you. So, thank you. Just stick to your preparation. That's, you will get your.
Yes.
So just stick to your preparation. You'll get your results. And it's nothing to, don't think too, it's just too much daunting. You know, I failed control theory in sixth semester. I failed modeling and simulation. I failed mass transfer. I failed modeling simulation in my BTech. So I did not understand a lot of mathematical concepts. And those things I started understanding after I got to job. So don't think it's not possible. It's very much possible. Especially if I had three fails of this in my BTech. So if I can do this, of course, everyone can do it. Just need to understand, just need to focus on what you need to do, and that's should be sufficient.
Yes sir, it was very much helpful talking with you, sir. So
yeah.
Definitely in future I would like to get a piece of light from you.
Yeah, I'm always reachable at the email ID. You can shoot an email, you can always contact Dinesh sir if I am not responsive. You can tell him.
Yeah.
If you want to convey some message, you can always tell Dinesh sir. I'm there, so sir, yeah.
Sure, sir.
So
thank
hope
you,
this
sir.
Is yeah, okay. So I'll disconnect the call. Hope that's okay.
Yes, sir. Thanks.